All right. Let's talk about what sync.Pool is, why it matters for performance, when it clears its objects, and how to use it properly so you don't fall into the heap allocation trap. To understand why sync.Pool exists, we need to talk about the problem, heap allocation. Heap allocation happens whenever a value needs to live longer than the function that created it. These heap objects appear in every Go program, and working with them comes with two main costs. First, allocation. That's the process of reserving memory space for the object. It's pretty fast, but still much slower than working with objects that are already on the stack. Second, deallocation. That's when the memory gets reclaimed once the object is no longer in use or reachable. Go doesn't require you to manually free heap memory like you would with the free function in C. Instead, it uses a garbage collector. The garbage collector automatically marks live objects, and any objects that are not marked are considered garbage. The garbage collector then reclaims that memory for you. The trade-off is extra overhead. It uses CPU time to iterate, mark objects, and sweep the unused ones. It also enables write barriers, which means updates to global and heap pointers are tracked, so those writes become a bit slower. And it briefly pauses the entire program during those garbage collection phase transitions. This is what's commonly called a stop the world pause. The solution for this overhead is, obviously, sync.pool. It's basically a cache for objects managed by the Go runtime. It stores the objects you give it and hands them back to whoever needs them. Go routines can put objects into the pool and let sync.pool manage them for you. You don't really know what's going on inside or how many objects are in there, and honestly, that's fine. Later, you can get an object back and reuse it instead of making a fresh allocation each time. And it's designed to be safe and efficient with concurrency, so multiple Go routines can grab from or return to the pool at the same time. Besides reducing the load on the garbage collector by reusing objects, it also manages the lifecycle of what it holds. Your objects don't live there forever, and we'll find out why in just a moment. Using sync.pool is pretty simple. There are just three things. First, you don't need a constructor. Just declare a variable of type sync.pool, and don't forget to import the sync standard package. If you want it to automatically create objects when the pool is empty, which is what you'll usually do, you set its new field to a function that returns the kind of object you want. Next, getting objects. You call the get function on the pool. It gives back an empty interface, so you'll almost always do a type assertion to the type you expect. It's also a good idea to reset the object before you use it, just to clear out any leftover state from its previous use. And when you're done, you call the put function to return the object to the pool so it can be reused. Behind the scenes, when you call the get function, the pool first tries to hand you an existing object. If there isn't one, it calls the new function you defined. And if you didn't provide a new function, get will just return Neil. The typical reason you'd skip providing a new function is when you want to control how the object gets created. If you look at the sync.pool struct definition, the new field is a function that takes no parameters. So if your object needs parameters to be initialized, you'll need to handle that manually. There's actually a good example of not providing a new field in the standard library's HTTP package. It defines its own new function that takes arguments. This function wraps the getFromPool logic to handle custom object creation based on the argument that was passed in and checks when the pool's get method returns nil. If there's no object available, it just allocates a new one using that argument. All right, that's the basics. If you take a closer look at how sync.pool is usually used, you'll notice that the new field, for the most part, returns a pointer. That's intentional because it helps avoid extra allocations. It's a bit out of scope and a little advanced, so I'll save that explanation for the end of the video. Okay then, when should we actually use sync.pool? Sync.pool is designed for short-lived objects that are created and discarded frequently. A common example is per operation data, like when you handle a single HTTP request. The Go routine gets an object from the pool, uses it, and modifies its state. Once it's done, it puts the dirty object back into the pool and responds to the client. After that, another request comes in, and another Go routine pulls that dirty object out, resets its state, and uses it again. Since these objects get reused so quickly, sync.pool is perfectly suited for this kind of use case. Now, why short-lived and frequently used objects? That's because if your objects sit in the pool for too long without being reused, the pool will eventually discard them, and they'll be garbage collected. But how long is long enough? The sync pool documentation says that any item stored in the pool may be removed automatically at any time without notification. Though, to be fair, that explanation feels a bit uncertain. It's actually quite complicated under the hood, but for our purposes, let's try to simplify it. The life cycle of objects in the pool is basically tied to the garbage collection cycle. Let's say the current garbage collection cycle is 1. Behind the scenes, sync.pool keeps 2 internal pools called locals and victim. When you put an object into the pool, or when the pool creates an object using the new field, it goes into the locals pool. Then some Go routines might take a few objects out, and some get left behind in the pool. When the second garbage collection cycle starts, all the remaining objects in the locals pool get moved over to the victim pool. Any objects that were already checked out by Gratines aren't affected. After that, both new objects and any objects you put back into the pool will go into the locals pool as usual. Then, the third garbage collection cycle starts. Everything in the victim pool gets cleared out and garbage collected. If you don't put anything back into the pool for a while, it eventually becomes empty. In other words, any object stored in sync pool will be cleared after at least 2 garbage collection cycles. I say at least because some objects in the victim pool can be moved back and reused when the locals are empty. But that's another story. And if this video is helpful so far, give me a sign by hitting subscribe and tapping the little bell so you'll get notified the moment I post something new. All right. Not all objects are, in fact, worth pooling. The best candidates are objects that are used frequently and are expensive to initialize or maintain. A good example of something you'd put in a sync pool is a bytes buffer. Let's understand why by looking at how it works under the hood. It's basically a thin wrapper around a byte slice. And as you probably know, a byte slice is just an array underneath with a fixed number of elements, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever. So imagine we grab a bytes.Buffer from the pool, and its underlying array currently has 2 elements. These elements are stored on the heap. So when you start appending data, but you fill up the first and second slots, everything's fine. But once you go past the slice's capacity, Go quietly allocates a bigger one on the heap and copies everything over. That's how it handles growth behind the scenes. And you just keep appending like nothing ever changed. And that original 2 element array becomes garbage, which of course adds extra work for the garbage collector. If you create a new bytes.Buffer for every request, you end up paying that growth cost over and over again, while also generating a lot of garbage for the garbage collector to clean up. With SyncPool, you can recycle buffers along with their already expanded slices. If a buffer has grown large in a previous use, you just call the reset function to move its length back to 0 while keeping its capacity. And that pretty much covers all the fundamentals. Now it's time to go back to our earlier question and see why we usually put pointers into the pool to avoid extra allocations. To understand this, we need to look deeper into how the empty interface works, because when you put an object into a pool, it gets boxed into the empty interface. In Go, an empty interface is represented internally by a struct called eface. This struct has 2 parts, one pointer to the type information and another pointer to the actual data. The key detail here is that the data field is itself a pointer. When you assign a byte, an int, or even a struct to an empty interface, Go copies the value and then sets the data pointer to that copy. Let's take an example. Suppose we have an integer a and we assign it to an empty interface b. The values of both the integer a and the empty interface b are stored on the stack. As we just discussed, assigning it to b creates a copy of a, and in this case, that copy also lives on the stack frame of the sample function. The data field of the empty interface then points to this hidden copy. That's why, if we change the value of A, the value stored inside the interface doesn't change. But here's the thing. The empty interface has an optimization that completely changes the situation when we use pointers. Let's say we have a pointer X that points to the variable A. Instead of assigning A directly to the empty interface B, we assign the pointer X to B. Let's map these variables to the stack frame to make it easier to visualize. In this case, there's no copy at all. The data field of the empty interface points directly to the memory slot that X refers to, which is A. This is the key idea behind using pointers with sync.Pool. By adding just one level of indirection through a pointer, we avoid making a copy every time we use it. Suppose we have a pool of integers. After retrieving one and setting it to 500, we return it to the pool using the put function. Since the put function takes an empty interface as its argument behind the scenes, passing an integer causes a copy of that integer to be created somewhere in memory. The variable A and the empty interface are allocated on the stack, but unfortunately the copy is allocated on the heap. The Go compiler's escape analysis is what decides which values get placed on the heap. You can confirm this by building the application with the GC flags-m. The compiler might print something like A escapes to heap. Escapes to heap doesn't mean the variable itself is moved to the heap. It just means a heap allocation is required to hold the value, while interestingly, the original variable can still remain on the stack frame. If you're still confused about how the compiler decides this during static analysis, think about it this way. A goroutine stack is private to that goroutine, like private storage. But the copy you put into a pool needs to be shared across multiple goroutines, so it has to move into a shared memory region that all goroutines can access, which is the heap. That's the logical answer, but if you want a precise one, it's because Go's escape analysis simply can't prove that your object is safe to be allocated on the stack after being passed to the put function. Let's change our example to use a pointer. When you get a pointer from the pool, that pointer refers to an object that's already allocated on the heap. It doesn't matter whether that object was just created or has existed for a long time. What matters is that when you call put, since it's already a pointer, the resulting interface points directly to the same object. No extra heap allocation is needed, which is exactly what we want. All right, that's the story of sync.pool. Short-lived objects, pointer tricks, and some clever garbage collector behaviors under the hood. If you've got an idea that could be a good next topic, leave a comment. And that's all for now. See you in the next discussion.